Just a couple of highlights before we dive in. Any questions, comments, thoughts, ideas before today's service? I again want to highlight the fact that it was wonderful that we had our youth helping out with the service. We tried something new this year. Rather than trying to teach the kids kind of independently to do different parts of the service and inviting them to volunteer to sign up, we just had like one service day. We've made them all come in and learn everything. So all the kids had to learn everything, and then we asked them to sign up for something, and so they did, and then they used it today, and then at second service there'll be some more kids do it, and it's great. We had some of the kids came in yesterday morning, helped set up for communion. They'll come back and take down communion. So they were all, every one of them said they had an area that they felt that they wanted to participate in terms of serving the Lord. And so I think this worked out pretty well. So we're glad to do that. About a month, 6 weeks ago, Pastor Kevin called me up and said, hey, would you be willing to have Dave come and speak to your congregation? He was speaking down at Rhinebeck with their LML, and part of your thing is when you're in an area, like, as many opportunities to talk in front of churches as you can. I said, there's no way we're going to let that happen. It's bad enough that you get to come up here and talk. I'm not going to let some stranger come into our congregation. He paid me $20 and I changed my mind, so.
Okay. 1 point for you. That was pretty good.
So you're easy.
Yeah.
You're easy.
Yeah.
I'm easy. So, no, we're very pleased to have with us. I don't have a lot of information on Dave, so I'm going to let him do his whole thing. But I know you're here from St. Louis and via the mission field. And so I said, we're going to give you the Bible study hour to tell us about the work of the Lord and what you do. And so you've got until 10:15 or so.
Okay, so somebody has a watch on, give me like a 5 minute warning. Like get my thing, say 5 minutes, wrap it up, because I am calendrically challenged and time really doesn't have much meaning for me. It was terrible when I was a teacher. Well, mostly for my kids. Oh wait, there was an assignment there. I'll go. Okay. So yeah, forgive me if I ramble on. There's like two people in the world who can talk more than a pastor, and that's a teacher and a missionary, and I'm both. You've been warned. It's a joy to be here, and as Pastor introduced me, my name is David Fiala, and I serve the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. Maybe you've heard of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod.
Yeah?
Can somebody tell me what the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod is?
It's not a Christian church.
It's us? Okay.
Not a Christian church.
It's a Christian church.
It's a Lutheran denomination.
It's a Lutheran denomination. You picked a really fun word there, denomination, because money comes in denominations, right? You got a $100 bill, you got a quarter, it's all money. It's a different denomination. I've often wondered how we put that word denomination together with a Christian concept. Okay, we got some good thoughts here. What else is the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod?
Bible believing.
Okay, so now you're getting into what we confess, what we believe, and what we teach. I feel like I should get hold of my Book of Concord. Okay? And what do we believe about the Bible?
Inerrant Word of God.
It's the inerrant Word of God. So we would say, oh, that's fluff, if somebody said the Bible just contains God's Word. We'd say that was kind of a weak thing to say about Scripture. Yeah? Because the Bible does more than contain God's Word. Because if you think, oh, the Bible contains God's Word, does it contain other things too? And do I get to pick which is God's Word and which is something else? In which case, what can we do? Well, just get rid of those pieces we don't like. You know, that whole book of Ecclesiastes that was kind of in our face this morning during the sermon. I don't want to hear that. All that law business. Those Ten Commandments? No. The part about, you know, only a man should be serving as a pastor? We don't, that's not about like women's lib and stuff. We can't have that. See, when the Bible only contains God's Word, you can start playing funny games. Now, is the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod known for playing funny games? 100% is 100%, right? We don't cut corners. So this is Lutheran Church Missouri Synod is not, we're not very hip with it these days, are we? We are certainly not a member of the woke culture you might be hearing about. I hear about it and I want to be sick. Okay? We have something to give to the world, don't we? We have God's truth. We have the fullness of Scripture in law and gospel to speak, to share. And why do we care to speak the law and the gospel? Why do we do it? It makes people angry. People who feel judged. Oh, you're judging me. Why do we speak God's word in its fullness, in law and gospel?
We need the law to show us our sin.
Because what?
We need the law to show us our sin.
Because the law will show us our sin, yeah, and you said? Because if you're going to go to heaven, what has to happen? You have to believe in Jesus. And believing in Jesus means that what has been fixed?
Sin.
Sin has been forgiven. If there's no forgiveness of sins, there's no absolution, we are still stuck, divided from God. The relationship, singular, the relationship that really matters is the relationship between the Creator God and us, His creation, and our relationship with Him. Okay, my dad was a plumber. I'm just a piece of pipe. All I do is connect stuff. And I'm a teacher. So I talk about how things are connected. And I look at that cross, and I see that there is this vertical, upward, downward piece. And when I see that, I think about, aha, that's God coming down to me with the forgiveness of sins, with the good gifts that He gives. He has restored that broken relationship by what Christ did. I used to teach about corporate worship. Who knows what corporate worship is? All of us together, like in divine service here. We're in a sanctuary. This is where corporate worship usually happens, right? And if we think about what goes on in corporate worship, who does the majority of the work in corporate worship? Is that your job and my job? Or is it God's job to do the majority of the work in corporate worship? It's God's job, okay? The downward arrow of God to us, God serving us, divine service, the divine serving His creation. Ooh, that's hard to unravel in English sometimes. Okay, He loves us so much that He gave us His Son. And through His Son, we have forgiveness, life, and salvation. That's the divine serving us. That's a big downward arrow I would draw on my whiteboard. It would be as wide as the whiteboard, all the way down. And I would say, in our participation in divine service, what does that arrow look like? This teeny little thing goes big, just a little guy, big. This big honking stuff from God, and our response is this tiny little thing by comparison. And yet we do thank and praise and serve our God. Okay? Then we think about that middle of the cross going back up. But it's a really small and not a very good effort because we're so sinful and we're just so we're broken people, aren't we? And yet, broken as we are, the Lord has restored the relationship. He has made us His own children. He put Jesus' name on me in my baptism. And He put it on you in your baptism. And all of a sudden, you are a child of the King. Whoa, you're somebody! But don't get a big head. Okay? So what do? Well, this is one of those other two bits of the cross come in, that horizontal piece. And we Lutherans, we really get this, don't we? Think about when you were a kid. I got a kid in the back row. Kid in the back row. Do you remember when you were a kid? Yeah, well, I woke up this morning. I was still a kid. Are you learning Luther's small catechism? not steal. Oh, yeah, that's a big one. Okay, what else?
Do not covet.
Don't covet. So, okay, now we're thinking about the stuff that our neighbor has. And what's our job, according to Luther, according to the explanation of the Ten Commandments? Love your neighbor as yourself. Our job is not only to not steal his stuff. What's our role as a Christian? It's to help and serve our neighbor, keep and maintain and grow what he has. Yeah. So you look at the large small catechism, and you look at the Ten Commandments, and you see all of this stuff that is actually dealing with our relationship with God, those first few commandments. And then the next few commandments is all about our relationship with our neighbor. And it's not just how we're not supposed to not do stuff to our neighbor. It also talks about what we are supposed to do to our neighbor. And who is our neighbor? Said that guy to Jesus once upon a time in the Gospel of Luke. Who is my neighbor? What was Jesus' response to the man who said, who is my neighbor?
Everyone.
What was Jesus' response? You guys know the story. I know Pastor probably doesn't like try to extract information from you when you're here in divine service, right? It's usually not a conversation from the, well, you weren't even in the pulpit. You were here wandering. It's not a conversation from the pulpit. What did Jesus say to that man who was trying to justify himself about who is my neighbor?
Our neighbor is anyone who needs our help.
Yes.
He gave him the story of the Good Samaritan.
Oh, there it is! You must have been paying attention in Bible study class. Four marks. All right, okay, full marks back there. Jesus told the story of the Good Samaritan, yeah? A certain man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he got jumped, and he got mugged, and he got robbed, and he got kicked and beaten and left for dead! And then the priest came by. I gotta remain ceremonially clean. I can't. He might be dead. If I touch a dead body. And then the Levite came by and had the same reaction, right? You guys know the story. And then who came by?
The Samaritan.
Now who are the Samaritans?
Enemy.
Oh, the Samaritans. Those are like the half-breeds. Those are like they're like the people from Nebraska.
Our mission.
See, when I was a missionary in Slovakia and I would tell this story, we'd get to the Samaritan and I would say, and that's the gypsy. And the kids would all be like, I don't know that we in North America understand what a gypsy is in Central Europe. They're this people group that came from India just before the time of the Reformation. And in Europe, they were building and they had the trade guilds. And my dad would teach me a skill and I would teach it to my kid. And the gypsies came in. And all the trade skills had people in them and families assigned. And there was nothing left to do except, you know, be musicians and entertainers and like highway robbers. And the gypsies never fit into Europe because they don't look like Europeans. They look like people from India. Which don't look like Europeans. And today, in Central Europe, the gypsy population is like this, it just doesn't fit into society. I met a Lutheran pastor in Hungary who did ministry to the gypsy people. And I asked him what that was like, and he went, well, imagine this, David. We were caring for these gypsies, and we were at a camp, and we were teaching them very basic things like how to brush your teeth. How to wash your body. So we were actually teaching these children how to take off their clothes and go into a shower where there was water, and this is soap. And the strangest thing this pastor told me about these gypsy kids was when they were getting undressed, they would take off four pairs of underwear and three pairs of shorts and two pairs of pants. And I went, why in the world would they do that? And he went, because if they weren't wearing it on their body, one of their siblings would steal it from them. The gypsy came by and saw that man. Whoa. What did the gypsy do? What did that guy from Nebraska do? That whatever it is, that culture. story. He puts him on the donkey. He bandages up the wounds. He covers him in oil, cleans him up, takes him to an inn, and says, here's some money. Take care of this guy. And if this money I give you isn't enough, I will come back and give you more. And that man in the Bible story is, I mean, looked at Jesus like those kids in Slovakia looked at me when I said it was the parable of the good gypsy. They went, that is just a bunch of hooey. And then I said, think about it this way. It's not the man going from Jerusalem to Jericho who's the character in the story, it's you. The world, the devil, and your own sinful flesh have jumped you and left you for dead. You are unable to do anything to help yourself like that man in Jesus' story. And then that good gypsy comes along, and who is that good gypsy? It's Jesus himself. He picks you up, cleans you off, and says, I will pay. I will pay whatever is owed for the care of this person. That is how much you are loved. And that is how far Jesus degraded himself in order to love you. Because what's most important to Jesus? What's most important? And you're going to sound selfish if you say it out loud, but what's most important to Jesus?
Me and my salvation.
I am most important to Jesus. And each of you can say that. Say that right now. Just say it out loud. I am most important to Jesus. He loves you that much. When God made this awesome creation in which we live that we think is awesome and it's pretty broken, imagine how awesome it was before it was broken. He made this awesome creation. And in Genesis 3, when oops, happened, he was there and he came to Adam and Eve and says, I'm going to set this right. The seed of the woman is going to be right. And you and I, we live long enough away from that story to know who the seed of the woman is. He gave his very self on that cross to restore this relationship that was broken by our first parents. What is the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod? We are the bullhorn that delivers this message. That is what we are. We speak about this restoration of the Creator God with his broken, sinful, marred creation. We go around the world, we go right next door, and we share this news because we want these people and the people out there, and the people out there, and the people out there past the corn. We want them to have that correct relationship with their Creator God, because there's one promise that Jesus has not yet made good on. One promise. And what is that promise that Jesus has not yet made good on?
I'll be back.
That he's coming back. Okay? I said this yesterday to the elderly ladies over there in Rhinebeck. Jesus is coming back. And what does the church do until Jesus comes back? We what?
Spread the gospel.
We spread the gospel. You bet. We speak his word without apology and not like, Jesus loves you. Not like little scaredy cats. We proclaim Christ crucified. Like Paul did, just like the apostles did, just like the reformers did when Luther discovered that, oh, the gospel is getting kind of mucked up and cloudy here, guys. We got to get back to the pure teaching of grace alone, faith alone, scripture alone. That is our confession still today. Christ alone for you. There's nothing you can do to earn God. there's a ton you can do with that horizontal aspect of what you now do because you know that you are so loved. And that's what I get to do. That's my calling, is to remind people of this reality, that we are His church. And as church, it's not our job to just sit here on Sunday morning and, I'm going to enjoy worship this morning. That was a great sermon. It was, by the way, it was. You let me have it. You reminded me just how broken I am and stupid and sinful. And then you gave me the gospel. Okay? That's what it's about. And when we're church together, and we receive this stuff, and if it's the only thought on our mind is to go back out that door and go to the first restaurant and get lunch and then go back about our week, and we forget the bit about the horizontal beam of that cross and our neighbors, that they need the gospel, we've missed it. Okay, that's where I come in. That's my role these days within our church. I'm that guy who gets to light that fire back underneath you and remind you of what you already know. Because what I'm telling you, you've already heard before. And I'm here to offer concrete ways that you can be a part of what the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod is doing in mission. Now, as you walked in, you kind of came into your row, and there was like stuff sitting on maybe one of the first chairs. I want at least all of you to have at least one of these big full-size sheets of paper that has the picture of somebody on it. I want you to walk out of here with that, okay? And what this is, each of these little pieces of paper, and they got different photos, and there's different stories. This little half sheet, yeah, that's just me. This is if you ever want to get a hold of me and say, hey, I need somebody to kick me in the butt again. Can you remind me what my job is in the church? You call me and we'll talk, okay? Because that's what I get to do. Grab one of these big sheets, and all of a sudden you're going to learn about the Hansen family. Do you guys know the Hansen family? I ought to get a yup. Because your congregation is supporting their mission work. Yeah? And where's that other one here I had?
Not anymore.
Well, you used to. But you know of them. Okay. There was also one that had Julie Lutz on it. Yeah. Julie Lutz was supported by this congregation. Now, it's interesting because the world changed. It used to be that folks gave to their congregations in the offering plate, and the congregations would give part of that they didn't need to manage their own affairs and to run the lights and the heat and everything else, and they'd give that to their district. And then the district, you know, they knew what they needed to run what they were doing in their larger sphere of influence, and then they would take from that and they would give to Senate. And Senate, but oh, now we're back to Senate again. What was Senate again? Did we ever define what Senate was? You know when you get a bunch of lions together, right? What do you call a bunch of lions together?
Right.
A tribe and some birds, what do you call that? A flock and fish.
Schools.
We have all these wonderful plural nouns for animals. And I think we have one for Lutherans. It's called the Senate. We are a Senate of Lutherans. Okay? And if you ever watch those fish and those birds, when the fish are swimming, you see them at the aquarium, they have these little awesome videos, and you see it online, you see it on TV. Do you ever see the fish go boom and bump into each other? I've never seen that, and I've watched a lot of those videos. You watch the birds, see the birds all flying together, the starlings that just come down, and do they ever crash into each other? I've never seen it. And yet, Lutherans, do we have a tendency to crash into each other? Don't answer that question. I hope you're not recording it. Okay? Lutherans have a tendency to crash into each other. Okay, and this is also what I have the opportunity to do is say, hey, you're a congregation. What's your role in the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod? What's your role? You proclaim God's law and God's gospel. You administer His sacraments in this place. And your mission field is right around you. Okay? And that's awesome. Because I can't do that from St. Louis. And my congregation in St. Louis doesn't think, hey, Cedar Falls, that'd be an awesome place to like plant up a church. That's not, that's like the birds crashing into each other. So instead, we try to keep things aligned and moving together. But you know, we're big. We're like 6,000 congregations big. Across 50 states, big. Okay, we got a lot of things that can be crashing into each other if we don't, you know, think about what is our role and what is our responsibility. And one of the things that we do at the Senate level, so the top level of our church, we think tiers, the Senate, the district, the congregation, really need to flip that over. Because the congregation is the thing on top that's got the most reach, okay? Like the totem pole, if you will. And then, you know, beneath you, you have your support and your district, which is awesome and cool. Because they know what's going on in your larger geography. I met a man in, even further north and east of here in Iowa who says, why isn't there an LCMS congregation in this big town here? He has to go to He has to go to Minnesota to get to an LCMS congregation because there isn't one like in his territory. And he said to me, I'm visiting him in his home, can you do something about that? Well, remember the Senate of Lutherans and the birds crashing into each other. Me personally, no, but next time I see your district president, I'm going to ask him and say, hey, are you guys doing something? Because I know this guy up there who loves the church and wants to be part of a congregation, but there's nothing within a stone's throw. Is the Iowa district East doing something in this territory? And then all of a sudden, it's the district president to work within the district who, hey, maybe we can do a church plant up there. Here's our resources. Let's pool them. Let's do this. As Senate, sometimes the district says, hey, can you come and help us? So like the Indiana district, for instance. You know Indiana. Hoosiers. There's this place in Indiana called Gary. You guys know about Gary, Indiana, right?
Yep.
Did you know that we have an LCMS missionary living in Gary, Indiana, who does church in Gary, Indiana? Because there are people in Gary, Indiana who don't understand what Jesus did for them and why it matters. So the Synod, together with the Indiana District, because the birds aren't bumping into each other, sent Delwyn Campbell to be a missionary in that community where those people, when they gather, they don't have the resources in their own pockets to turn on the lights and run the heat in the congregation building that they inherited, that was built by previous generations of Lutherans. But they want to hear the gospel, and Delwyn wants to give it to them. So where does Delwyn like get his salary from, and his benefits?
The district.
The district helps a little bit, but you help because you're like, hey, I can't go to Gary, Indiana, and give the gospel to those people, but thank goodness Delwyn can. Can I help Delwyn in that mission that he's been called to? I didn't hear anybody say yes. Can I help Delwyn in that mission that he's been called to in Gary, Indiana?
Yes.
This is how it works. And some, did you guys even know Delwyn Campbell before I said it 2 minutes ago? This is what I get to do. I get to share these stories of what our church is doing in mission. And each of these pages is a photo and a story about a family or an individual who's doing mission work like this somewhere. Delwyn is, he's pretty special and unique. He's the only guy doing this in North America. All the rest of these folks, they're all doing this somewhere else in the world. The Jastrams are in Japan. The Jasis are in Uruguay. Who knows where Uruguay is? South America, Brazil, the really big honking country. Uruguay, the teeny tiny little guy. Yeah, it's down there. Do you know what's down in Uruguay? This crazy atheist population of European immigrants, kind of like our European immigrant parents that came to this nation. A lot of them went to South America as well. A lot of Germans down there. But for whatever reason, time and history, and the devil, and our sinful nature, okay, drove out spirituality and the gospel and the relationship with the Creator. It's this hugely atheist country in the Western Hemisphere. And we have a pastor and his deaconess wife who are going there to build church. Not with a hammer, You heard my children's message in first service, but with the Word of God. Can you go to Uruguay and build church? Can you help the Jasiffs? I didn't hear much of a response.
Yeah.
Okay. Each of these missionaries has a similar story. Now, we're sent, right? We are the Lutheran Church in Zurich Synod. I've got a couple of handouts I'm going to give you. And this should be fun. Because organizations, the Synod is an organization, often have a unifying statement called a mission statement, right? It helps the birds fly around without bumping into each other. Thank you. And some for the folks over here. There you go. So if our mission statement is unifying and it gives us direction, it prevents those crazy Lutherans from bumping into each other, right? So let's take a look at this. How many of you know what the LCMS mission statement is? How many of you know that we even have one? Okay, it's apparent that my job is very necessary. Okay? So open the sucker up, and you'll see underneath this photo, there's this little paragraph sentence. You know, we German Lutherans love paragraph sentences. Let's read it, shall we? In grateful response to God's grace, and empowered by the Holy Spirit, through word and sacraments, the mission of the Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod, is vigorously to make known the love of Christ by word and deed within our churches, communities, and world. That's the Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod. That is who we are. That is what we do. We make the news of Jesus known vigorously. We do this in word and deed. We do this at the very beginning of this. In grateful response, we acknowledge that, boom, this happened first. And in response to that, we seek out those other people who, like us, have been jumped and left for dead on the roadside. We go to them as the very hands and feet of Jesus. Now, how do we do that? I have a second handout. And this one is, oh my goodness, Pastor, I totally forgot you over there. I have neglected my duties terribly. This little folder of information talks a lot about the how. How we do this together. When you open this puppy up, you're going to see that we do this kind of work domestically, internationally. We do this through Mercy. We do this through schools. And on the backside, we even have publications that talk about what we do. And we have partners. So we're not in this mission alone. And my invitation to you is to look at this and ask yourself, which one of these things tugs on my heartstrings? Maybe Gary, Indiana is just not of great interest to you. Maybe Uruguay is just not of great interest to you. My question is, what is? What turns your crank? What people group or slice of society would just give you joy to be a part of the church reaching that segment of society? I want to know what that is. And that's what I get to do. I get to listen to folks tell me I only have 4 minutes left and I better cut to the chase. 3 minutes left, I better cut to the chase. I get to invite. And you know what I don't do? I don't find people and put their arm behind their back and say, give money to support the church. Never. I will never do that. I will tell the story of what the church is doing, and I will invite you to pray and consider this. Because you know what? You, each of you, have a relationship with your Father, and you understand what He has done for you. And each of you has been given resources. None of my business what your resources are. That's between you and your father. And if you and your father talk about this, and you and your wife talk about this, or you and your husband talk about this, and you say, Mom, I think we can do this. Let's go ask David if we can do this to bless the work of the church. And what am I going to say? Oh, you better tack another $5,000 in there. Am I going to say that? No! I'm going to say, awesome! Thank you! You don't believe me? I just wrote a gift proposal last week for a pastor who said, my wife and I, we want to make a reoccurring gift of $15 a month. Direct withdrawal from our checking account, and we want to give it to Soldiers of the Cross. Soldiers of the Cross is a special fund that the LCMS uses to bless church workers, pastors, teachers, deaconesses, DCEs, etc., who something has happened to and they're having a difficult time. That individual talks to their local pastor, talks to the district president talks to Senate and says, this person's in need. And Soldiers of the Cross goes, how can we help them? If it's physical dollar resources, we'll give it. This is what we do as Senate. And I wrote that gift proposal for that pastor the same way I wrote a gift proposal for a farmer in Central Illinois who was selling his shares of a business he used to work for that equaled $36,000. I had just as much joy in my calling working with the pastor who gave 15 bucks as this former business CEO kind of a guy who gave $36,000. Is the Lord going to use both of those gifts to the glory of the advancement of his church? Yes. Who's the Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod? What do? We spread the gospel and we bless this creation and we help to restore that broken relationship. Can we have a prayer together? Heavenly Father, good and gracious God, thank you for a day. Thank you for another day of life that you have given us all that we need. Thank you for being our Savior. Thank you for forgiving our sin. Thank you for calling us into the community of this congregation. Lord, we ask that you will use us to further your kingdom, to speak your gospel, and to proclaim and point people to Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. Thank you guys for your attention.
Thank you, Dave. Thank you. All right, make sure you pick up a mission information sheets.
And you don't want to be hanging out in the church.
We don't, make sure we